Good morning. It's very early. But thank you very much for still being brave enough to get up early and to listen to an English talk. Nonetheless, I will try to keep you awake. And today I will talk about how the world gets into the brain. 저는 뇌경학과 크리스티안 왈라벤입니다. 안녕하십니까? So, to keep you entertained, let's start with a very quick test. Yes, it's very early, but this is a very simple test, actually. In the next slide, you will see a picture, an image, for a very, very short time. Very short time. Please pay attention to this picture on the screen. You don't know what it is, but just try to tell me afterwards what the picture contained. Okay, if you're ready, then let's take a look. Okay, one, two, three. What did you see? It was fast, right? What did you see?
Many people on the street.
Many people on the street. What else? Where was this?
Night, sir.
Huh? Night, sir. Night, yes. Which country? Could you see something? Any country?
Korea.
Korea? So, well, many people on the street. It was night. Where was this? What kind of street was it? Just lots of cars? Probably not. Did you see any cars? No cars. Did you see restaurants? Restaurants? Or did you see text? So this picture, it's completely correct that many people on the street at night. It is Myeongdong, so you can see that. Now, this picture is very blurry, and I showed it to you for only a few milliseconds, actually. But still, your brain had enough time, even though you didn't know what I was going to show, to look at this picture and to interpret some of the things. Now, if I show this picture to you now, since you're all Korean, you will start reading texts like this, you know. But actually, if you show it to my brain, the first thing I will see is PC, because that's my alphabet, right? If you show it to a Chinese person, they will look at this first. Now, these are the same pixels. This is the same picture. But your brain looks at those pixels, and it's able to tell you in a very, very quick flash what the image is about. So the story of this picture, nighttime scene with lots of pedestrians, lots of shops, perhaps. This you can get in a few milliseconds, and your brain does this automatically. But you have to remember that what the brain just did for you was take a few million pixels, which you didn't know anything about, and interpret them. So the world itself floods our sensory system with gigabytes of information every second. And the brain somehow has this wonderful ability to extract, pull out meaning and structure from this amount of data very, very quickly and robustly. And it has been estimated that if you want to measure how fast the brain really computes, that the brain has about 20 million billion operations per second, which is a lot. And my interest is what kind of algorithms does the brain use? How does the brain do this? And essentially to answer this question, how does the world get into our brain? And I will tell you a few sort of loose stories today about how this works. I will tell you actually how the brain should not be actually capable of seeing in the first place, but how the brain solves this problem. I will tell you a bit about how things are represented in the brain, how the brain thinks about the world, and how we, when we touch things, that helps, and how, a bit at the end, how faces and facial expressions are processed. This is a lot of things to take in, but I will just keep it very, very light and entertaining, I hope. So, You know, we can take another scene, which is also one of my favorite scenes. This is a computer-generated picture. Obviously, you can see it's an office scene. It's indoors. You can also see there's lots of chairs in this picture. Now, you don't have any problem to detect the chairs in this picture, even though you haven't seen those chairs before, you haven't seen that picture before. But even though there has been lots of progress in computer vision, for example, there is no computer program that can do this, really. You can't find any machine that takes this picture and tells you where chairs are. And there are a number of reasons why the brain is very magical in this capability. For example, you know that this is a chair, even though you only see half of the chair, right? The rest is behind the table. You also know that this is not a chair you can sit on, because it's actually on the table. But these pixels here, this chair, is the exact same chair as this chair. But this chair is in the back of the room, so you can sit on it. Now, how does the brain do this? This is the same pixels, this is the same image, right? Of course, the brain knows about the scene structure. This is a 3D room, so this is in the back of the room, and therefore must be a smaller chair. But this is something the brain does for you automatically. You didn't even have to think about it. Probably also you didn't really notice this guy here, because it's a bit, you know, weird. And also that is why what the brain does for you. Weird things are a bit unexpected and you don't notice them that much. Also, if you want to program a computer to do this, you could ask, well, maybe we process, let's take this chair here, maybe we process like the surroundings, the silhouette of the chair, and then we can recognize chairs. Now, here is the silhouette of a chair, but this is not a chair. It's the shadow of this chair thrown by this lamp. Now, the silhouette of this chair is the exact same silhouette as the silhouette of this chair, but still, your brain has no problem to confuse them. Also, you can recognize that this is a chair that has been disassembled. You can recognize that this is a very strange chair. You can probably recognize that you can sit on this, but that it's more like a table. You can recognize that this is a picture of a chair in a picture of chairs. Yeah? Your brain does this automatically. You don't even have to think about this, but if you think about what the brain needs to do to tell you all this, it still is very magical, somehow, to me still is. So the idea is also, you can see that if you look closely, there's a chair here, it's very much hidden. You have no problem if you look closely to detect that this is a chair as well. So our brain has amazing capabilities to reason, and to think about the world. And of course, you know, it does this for you every millisecond. Every millisecond you walk around, you do things like this. And your brain helps you to do this you want to understand things, right? So, but if you look closely at it, it's actually not really clear how the brain can achieve this even, because there is so much information and so many ambiguities, so many things that can go wrong. So, how does the world get into the brain? It works like this. You actually start here, and then you make a circle. And I will go through that circle now to explain it to you a bit. So, let's imagine you are in this room, and it's actually not a picture, but a real room. And I told you there's tons of information that comes to your brain. Of course, what you see, but of course, at the same time, also what you hear, what you smell, what you can touch, how your body is like, this is another sense, whether you feel pain, how hot it is, and so on and so forth. So all of this is input to your brain every millisecond. This is what we call the environmental stimulus. It's a fancy word for everything that comes into the brain. You can just call this input. Okay, so this is a lot. So somehow the brain needs to select something from this information to process. So we attend to something. Let's just say for fun that you start to look at this thing here. And right now it's even nothing. Right now the only thing that happens is that your eye sort of looks at this. So this is what is called the attended stimulus. You attend to this part of the scene. Now once you do that, the picture of this chair gets thrown onto the back of your eye. So this is the eye. That you have a lens here, which is similar to a camera. Now, fun fact, in your eye, because of optics, the image, the picture gets turned upside down. Now, we don't perceive the world upside down, but on your back of the eye, it's upside down. Okay? So this guy, which is upside down because it's on the ceiling, actually in the retina gets turned right way up. Now, this is just basically optics, and the ear does something as well, and my skin does something as well. So this takes whatever you look at and sort of makes it so that you can take a picture from it, and that picture then goes to the brain. So in the back of the eye, in the back of the eye here, this yellow stuff, these yellow stuff are your camera detectors. So we have a lot of them, and they're called receptors, and they look like this. You have several kinds. Now this is what happens in the eye. So actually there's a lot of strange stuff happening, but suffice to say that once light hits these guys, they convert the light energy, they convert it to electricity. This is very similar to a solar cell, right? Except that we don't produce energy, we actually produce electrical signals. And your brain has two types of camera elements. We have the cones, they look like cones, and we have rods, they look like rods. Just to remember this, with the cones, they start with a C, you see color. With the rods, you cannot see color. Cones, they enable you to see in daylight, and rods, they turn on at nighttime. These guys, they're your night camera, okay? They're very sensitive, but they don't give you color, which is why when you wake up at night, there is no color, okay? Everything is gray at night. This is because those guys, they don't come in color versions. These guys come in color versions, but for that, they only work if there's enough light. Okay, so this is called transduction. You take light and you make it into electricity. Now with that electricity, don't worry, this just looks complicated, but you have the two eyes here, and the two eyes convert whatever you see into electricity. This electricity is wired into the visual processing of the brain. Okay, now, do not ask me why, but for some reason, nature, or whoever is in charge, has decided that it's a good idea to have visual processing in the back of the brain. So actually, you have your eyes here, but your visual processing starts here. No idea. Doesn't make any sense to me, but that's how it is. So this is called sort of the perceptual process starts really here. So the electrical energy gets routed here through this, and the computer starts to do things here. So this is where your computer sits. Now, the result of this computation is what we call perception. The perception, remember this was the picture that came in. The perception will tell us that something is there, something. This guy, whatever that is. So this, at this stage, I can begin to talk about it. Before then, I'm not aware that my rods and cones do something. But now here, I start to become aware that something is there. And because the brain is not happy about something, it wants to put a name on most things, it will try to recognize this thing. Okay, so now we know that it's a chair. And if the brain has more information about the surrounding, we also know it's a chair on the ceiling. So this is usually where we work at, right? If I walk into that room, this will be something that my brain gives to you. So all this stage here happened automatically, okay? I didn't even need to think about this. Now usually, and this is also very important, our brain doesn't exist just like for fun, right? We want to do something with our world. We always do something. We don't sit idle around. We interpret. We want to do something. So after recognition comes action. Now, if there's a chair on the ceiling here, I better duck because it will fall down. You know, it's very uncommon for chairs to be on the ceiling, but if there were one, I would take cover. So that's an action. And now with this action, something changes in what you see and you start the whole circle again. But there's also knowledge. Now knowledge in the brain can influence anything, influence any stage of these processes here in the brain. Now you can imagine, oh wait a second, I've seen this cool chair lamp before. So it's a chair lamp, I mean, I don't know, you know, just for fun. Now if this is a lamp, of course, I don't need to take action like this. I can take a different action, I can look at a different part of the scene. So knowledge in the brain influences all of these steps. What I know already, what my brain knows already, will influence how I see and how I perceive the world, what actions I take, and what I do with that. So, all good and fine. This is just theory, it's nothing really dramatic. Now, I want to tell you why actually seeing is really impossible in principle. So let's imagine we have this chair and I've selected a nicer picture of a chair. It's upside down. In the real world, this chair is in three dimensions, okay? It has three dimensions. The world is three-dimensional. So it becomes, however, two-dimensional if we put it onto our camera, onto our eye, right? So in this step, unfortunately, we lose one dimension. Now, this works even if I close one eye. I'm not talking about two eye processing, I'm just talking about one eye even, okay? Now, for some magical process, of course, this information, this picture here goes to the back of the brain where it's being processed. And somehow we have a very, very clear idea in our head that this chair, whose picture is 2D, is actually a normal chair, it's a 3D picture. Even if I close one eye, I have no problem to interpret the world as a 3D world. So now we have a big, big problem. We are taking data, and we are throwing away parts of it, and somehow our brain needs to come up with the missing dimensions. Now even if I don't do any of the real math with you, you will probably agree that this mathematically, going from this to here, is really not possible because I lost data. And I lost data in a way that I cannot recover that data. It's really gone. So, actually seeing mathematically is not possible. Doing this step mathematically is impossible. But we have no problem to see in 3D, so how can we do this? Well, I told you about knowledge, okay? So our brain knows something about objects like chairs. It knows something about 3D structure. So with that knowledge, it can take that picture and make it into 3D, perhaps. Perhaps it's not really very successful, but you can try, right? You know something about it, and you can try to estimate the rest of it. This is very much like me reading a Korean email, right? I get a Korean email. I know 10% of the words, and I try to make up the rest of it because of my knowledge, right? So this is the same. So, but without any knowledge, with those 10% of the words I understand, I could get nothing. But with my knowledge that I have about what the email may be about, I can maybe interpret this. So this is the same idea with the brain now. Now, going from 3D to 2D is actually no problem. This is a very old painting, no, it's not a painting, it's an etching, by Dürer, one of the German guys in the Renaissance. And he gives this instruction to this guy, how to paint a proper, perspectively correct picture. So imagine you want to make a picture of this guy, of this music instrument here, from this perspective. So how do you do that correctly? You take a frame, a wooden frame, and you put a canvas into that frame here. And now you take this stylus here, and you fix a rope to it that you tie at the point from which you want to take that picture. And now you put this stylus on various points on the music instrument, and you follow where this guy pierces this canvas. And that's where you put the point. So in this particular case, he just shows the picture to you that results from this. So if you move this guy here, you will get this point. If you move this guy here, you will get that point in the back. And the picture will be perspectively correct. Okay? So if you change this point to here, the picture will change. Now this is, you know, is a fun demonstration somehow, how to do this correctly, mechanically, so to speak. But like I said, in this picture, you have lost information. It's not the real 3D picture, it's a 2D picture of a 3D object. So this works, and we also know how cameras work, so this is how things happen. Now, if you want to go from 2D to 3D, if I show you this picture, you'll probably say it's a cube. Pretty much everybody sees this as a cube. So this, let's say this is what you see. Even here, you would say this is a cube. But if you follow the projection rules, actually this is the object that's a cube that makes this picture. But this is another object that's not a cube that also makes this picture. And this is another object that also makes this picture. Now why do you see a cube here? You could see this object, you could see this object. All of them are possible. I told you again, why we see the cube is because our brain knows something. And I will tell you now about some of these assumptions that the brain has. But just to demonstrate this a bit further, let's show you a movie. So this is a cube, right? It's rotating. So now it stands still. It's still a cube for you. Okay? Good. Start with a cube again. This is another object rotating. Now it's a cube. But what you just saw while it was rotating was a very, very different object. But once it stands still, it's a cube again. So I show you another object, which is also a cube. This one. Also a cube. But once it rotates, it's really not a cube. Now it's a cube. Now, when it rotates, your brain gets more information about the object and says, wait a second, that's not a cube. But once it stands still, the brain snaps back and tells you, well, the best thing I can talk about this is a cube. But in reality, this object was definitely not a cube. It was a crazy object that I made by shifting this guy very much back. So actually, anything I do to this guy here, if I pull this out, will not change the picture. Okay? But your brain likes certain interpretations better than others. And of course, Of course, this makes much more sense. You know, this is not such a crazy object. It's an object we are known to deal with. It's a simple object. It's not so complex. So in the real world, it's probably more likely that this guy happens to you than any of these guys. So this one, I've never seen that object before. And it's very unlikely to occur. Same with this one. So your brain makes assumptions how it interprets this picture. And those assumptions, they can be wrong. Okay? Most of the time, they're correct. Some of the time, they're wrong. This one here is an extreme example. You see the shadows here? It's a romantic, well, maybe, I don't know, romantic. Some kind of sogeting. there's two people, person smoking, person drinking a wine glass. Now, this is the shadow of this garbage heap. That's the shadow. You put a light source where pretty much I'm standing here, like this, and the shadow of this garbage heap will be this couple. And you can see this one here, this piece is the cigarette. And this here is the glass. So this is, it's an art installation, obviously, by a very, very nice artist who I happen to like. This is the extreme version of this problem, right? If you see this shadow, you say it's two people, because that is what you know about. That's the most likely interpretation. But because it's 2D, anything can make that shadow, including a pile of trash. So, of course, most of the time when you see this, you're correct, it's two people doing this. But in principle, mathematically, again, you can be fooled in an infinite number of ways. It's just that most of the time, the brain has the correct kind of knowledge. So what other pieces are there? So this is a picture here. I hope you can see it properly. Yes. It's a wall. And I can ask you, are these guys, are there stones in the wall, on the wall, or are they holes inside the wall? What do you see this guy as? Stones or holes? Do they go into the picture, or do they get out of the picture? What do you think? Rocks. Rocks on the wall? Yeah? Okay. Let's go with that. What about now? Rocks or holes? Holes. Okay. Now, what I did was just to rotate this guy, okay? And your brain switches. It's just the same picture. There's really nothing magical about it. I just flipped it around. And when the brain looks at this picture, actually, mathematically, this is three-dimensional. This is a picture of a three-dimensional scene. But again, it's just a picture. So your brain needs to interpret this picture. But it's mathematically impossible. So actually, mathematically, you cannot tell. It's impossible to tell whether this is a hole or whether it's a stone. Now, you still see a stone or a hole, depending on which picture I show you. And why is that? Well, the brain knows something more. So let's say, if, for fun thing, which is a good assumption, usually the light, the sun, comes from above. Okay? Now it does, for example. The light source in the room comes from above. If the light comes from above, then the upper part of this will be bright if it's a stone. Okay? So if it's a stone coming out like this, this upper part here will be bright, and this lower part will be dark because it's in the shadow. Okay. Now, if the light comes from above, then if this is a hole, the lower part will be bright because the sun shines onto that hole, and the upper part inside the hole will be dark. And there we have it. And that's why you see a hole or a stone. This picture itself does not have that information. Your brain has that information. And your brain makes that picture into one interpretation or another. And you can also ask, why does the brain do this? Well, because the brain needs interpretation. The brain is very hungry for unambiguity. Okay? You want to interpret. You need to see something as one and one interpretation only. So these guys here are called convex, they come out. These guys are called concave, they bend in. And the reason why you see this is because you assume that light comes from above, which is a reasonable assumption in daily life, right? The sun is outside, it's usually up in the sky. Therefore, most of the time when we are outside, light comes from above. Once you make that assumption, this interpretation becomes unique. Okay? But without this knowledge, mathematically, both of these pictures are ambiguous. So here's another fun one. I will rotate this guy. This is a mask of a face. Okay? It's a mask. It's not the real face. It's not a skull. It's just a hollow mask like this, okay? Like you see in the theater. And I'll rotate this for you, and you can watch what happens. So it rotates. Now you can see inside, but look. And now it rotates. Something very weird happened when it rotated. Okay, I can do this again. So it rotates. Now you're looking inside, but it doesn't seem like inside. It still seems like the face comes out again. Okay, but all I'm doing is I'm taking a face mask which looks like this, and I'm rotating it like this. I don't do any tricks. Okay, so just for fun, I can do this with an actual textured mask like this. So it's rotating, and now it seems to look at you again, and now things are weird. And again, this is the same problem. Mathematically, whether this guy goes inside or outside is actually not specified. Mathematically, this could also be a convex face like this. But of course, faces are never convex, concave, sorry. It could never be like this, okay? Faces aren't like this. And we see millions of faces when we are walk around. So for faces, our brain has an automatic assumption that a face is convex always, even if we rotate the mask, and even if you know that the mask is rotating like this. I really challenge you to try and see that the face is like this when you look at it inside. It really, I mean, for me, it doesn't really work. So I can do this again. Try to see it properly. So try to see the mask. Oh, hope it starts. There we go. You have both of them. So right, try to see inside. It's very hard. It's very hard to see a face that's like punched inwards, okay? And why is that? Well, this is because, there we go, I can rotate it again. It's because we're an expert for faces. It has nothing to do with the light. It just has to do with that we know faces a lot, and we see millions of faces over our lifetime, and we know for sure that every single face we have seen ever is a convex object. It bulges out. We never see a face like this. So again, the input is ambiguous. And our brain takes knowledge that it has to make it unambiguous. So now, remember this guy here. I flashed it to you very, very quickly, and you didn't know what it would contain, but you still got it was nighttime, there were lots of people on the street, it was maybe Korea. And now I'll try to make it a little bit more difficult, so we're going to do another test. And in this test, I show you a picture, and your task is to find the blonde lady with the pink shirt and sunglasses, okay? It's very easy, very obvious person, okay? Raise your hand if you got her. It's hard, right? Anybody got her? Yeah? Okay, I can help you. Obviously, this is very hard, right? Obviously, it's very hard. Why is it hard? Well, you get that this is an outdoor scene with lots of people, probably some kind of festival or something like this in some kind of Western town, because those are mostly Western people. That's it. You get this in 1 millisecond. I don't even need to show the picture for you for that long. But you don't have enough capacity to really go through every single person here at the same time. So what you need to do is very costly. And if I help you, she's actually here. Yeah. So now it's super easy for you. Now it takes you 0 seconds to do this, right? If I give you a little bit of hint, look here, you will find her in 0 seconds. So your brain has amazing processing capacity, but it's not enough for this. And also, usually that's not what you want to do, unless you lost your child in this sort of, you know, sea of people. Then you want to do this. But our brain is not so good at this. We can't do this because it's too much information. Important information like outdoor scene in summer, festival, people, Western city, you get in no time. But this information about every single person here is not useful for you, and it's too much processing. So if you solve this task, you actually move your eyes around like this. You like focus every single person, and then you interpret and ask, is that a blonde lady, and so on. So when you look at a face, for example, that's what your eyes do. So this is a picture of a face here, and your eyes will fixate this eye, and then this eye, and then the mouth, and then they will go back. Actually, in fact, most of the time, if I just show you a face, your eyes will not do very much. In fact, most of the time, when I show you a face, you're not interested in, for example, this part at all. Unless I ask you, what hairstyle does this person have? Then you will look there. So your eyes are sort of the picture of attention here, okay? So you say you pay attention to eyes and the mouth. And of course, these are important for recognizing a person, seeing what they talk, and so on. So in the previous scene, your eyes actually had to costly like walk through every person here in the crowd because there is not enough capacity in the brain to process everybody at the same time. So, sometimes there's too much information. Therefore, I have to switch to here. Okay, these are two pictures. There's something changing between them. These are not the same pictures. Can you find what changes between them? You got it? Got it? Some people got it. Everybody? No? Let me help you. So, fun thing, right? You can interpret both pictures in 0 milliseconds because you can see that tourists probably in Egypt. No problem for both pictures. But you can't keep this in memory. You can't keep those pixels in memory because I'm flashing a gray screen in between. If I didn't do this, you would have a picture and then one thing would change. You would immediately see this. It takes you 0 seconds, your gaze would be here. But because I'm resetting your brain in between with a gray flash, your brain has no capacity to process this scene. So you're at a loss. So your brain can't do this. I'll show you another one. Everybody got it, huh? Here. This is a really big change, right? I mean, but our brain is not interested in that. It's actually not so important. I mean, important interpretation for the brain is this is a happy couple from the 80s. You can look at the horrible, horrible hairstyle. And so they're doing something. And, you know, we don't have the capacity to process everything and keep it in memory to process for the next time. So I will show you one more. Yeah? It's pretty important. Yeah? So, same thing again. You get that these are some soldiers boarding a plane here, but, you know, you don't have to, even though, actually your brain, you know, I mean, this is a very important part of an airplane, seriously. So if this is missing, sometimes, I mean, if I showed this picture to you and you had a little bit of an idea, you would say there's something missing here. But again, your brain does not have this capacity to do this. Your brain cannot pay attention to every part of a picture. So, actually, why? Why don't we do this? It seems important, right? It seems that we should notice this kind of stuff. Well, actually, most of the time is really not necessary because if I stand here right now and I close my eyes, I open my eyes, you're still here. Okay? If some of you vanished suddenly, it would be magic. And this doesn't happen in the world. The world actually is a very boring place. It doesn't change that quickly. So why should our brain then spend those resources on memorizing? It's not necessary. So our brain is actually lazy. Okay? We don't need to do this because if we want to check what the world is doing, well, we just look, open our eyes and look around. The world hasn't changed much from one time to the next. We don't have to do this. Haha. Okay, so here, informal experiment. What color is this for you guys? They usually, wait, I'll give you some choices to make it easier. Who thinks it's white gold? Okay. Who thinks it's blue-black? All right. Who thinks it's blue-brown? Excellent. So, people know this, right? It was very famous at the beginning of this year, right? So this is a picture of actually a very bad picture. It's a very horrible photograph of a dress. And somebody posted this and said, you know, can you help me? What color is this dress? And then it got famous because, like you, some people see it white gold, some people see it blue black, some people see it blue brown, and pretty much nothing else. Now, this is very interesting because usually that doesn't happen that way. Actually, the truth is this. That's the actual dress. And as you can see, it's uniquely blue black. So for those people who saw it white gold, yeah, this is the actual dress. And so it wouldn't be that interesting because we all know this. If you look at the squares here, these two guys, they have, you would probably say they look different in color, right? This square and this square have different color. Yeah, we can agree? Okay. So of course, I'm a nasty guy, so they're actually not different. Yeah? And I can give it back to you. The reason why this happens is because the brain does never see things out of context. This color influences this color, and this color influences this color. So they are not independent. And we know this. And now the fun thing is, if I ask every one of you which color this guy is and which color this guy is, you would see similarly weird colors. Okay, everybody agrees that this is a different color from this. But that happens for every one of you in the same way. Now, let's go here. So, actually, these two things physically are the same. I can put a photometer here and measure the light intensity and color, and it will be the same. Now, your brain, as we have seen many times now, your brain does not do physics. Actually, your brain does a lot of dirty tricks, as we've seen, right? Why does the brain need to do this? Well, it doesn't have enough data sometimes. So we know perception is not physical measurement. It is not. It is knowledge plus physical measurement. So, okay, we know this. Most people will see the same colors now and they wouldn't see the same colors before. But the dress, it's only one image and every one of you gets the same image. And for some people, it looks white gold. And for some people, it looks blue black. This means perception is not only not physics, but it also is subjective, which means your brain and my brain are different. This is interesting because, you know, this is a very powerful demonstration of this fact. Some people will see the dress this way, some people will see the dress another way. So where does this come from? It started actually this year, February 2015, and it of course went viral, and of course, you know, scientists were asked, what's okay? And then we had to do something, so we came up with some studies, and I will briefly share with you what people have thought about so far. So this is like real cutting-edge science we're doing here. So first thing that scientists do is actually they look at this picture, and they look at the pixels of this picture. So they just take these pixels, and for each pixel they say, okay, this pixel looks white. Is actually a white pixel. Like in Photoshop, you can measure this, right? You can click on a pixel and say, which color is that pixel? So this is this. It's basically a color sorting of all those pixels here. And if you take these out of context, you will see that actually the colors that are contained in this picture are mostly blue and brown. This looks like blue to me mostly, this looks like brown, maybe gold-ish, but mostly dirty brown. So actually, for those people who saw blue-brown, they are pixel analyzers. Okay? They just look at, really, they don't interpret that much. But for those people who saw black and blue, or white and gold, they obviously must have done something very different to get at this. You can see that there is some white and gold, but actually white and gold is the smallest part of this picture. And for the life of me, I cannot see strong blue, and there's definitely no black in this picture whatsoever. There's no black here. So the pixels are obviously not the whole story. So the pixels say blue, black, brown, blue. Now, if you do this experiment with lots and lots of people, most people will see the dress as blue-black. A third will see the dress as white-gold, and around 10% will see the dress as blue-brown, and there are some crazy people. And actually, it doesn't matter whether you ask people who know something about the dress, whether you ask, even it doesn't matter whether you ask color scientists, right? People who study color for a living. It doesn't matter. They all see this in very similar proportions. Now you can ask, okay, so anything that makes some people different from other people, and you find something. So here is how much a person sees white gold, okay? 100% would be everybody, like 100% white gold. And the x-axis is how old you are. You can see something. If I increase the age, this guy goes up, okay? So as you get older, you tend to see more white gold. Now you can ask, why should color change with age, okay? But yeah, that's one of the data here that you can find. So now, what color is the dress? What color? Okay. I ask especially those people who answered blue-black before. Okay. So for most people, this dress now will look white-gold. So I can switch it for you. What about now? What color is the dress now? Especially those people who answered white gold before. It looks blue-black to me, at least, even though the monitor. But, of course, as you will know, the pixels of the dress remain the same. The only thing I did is I gave you additional information about the color of the environment. You will see that this is a face, and the face has looks bluish, right? So it looks like this whole scene is being illuminated by blue light. And if it's illuminated by blue light, suddenly you seem to think, oh yeah, it's a white gold dress. But if you assume the scene is illuminated by yellow light, then suddenly it becomes a blue-black dress. So, why this? Well, again, the brain doesn't have enough data. So, here's the sun. The sun is red in this case. It shines red light on a blue object. Now, this blue object is blue, but the light is red. So, what is being reflected to the eye is both types of information at the same time. So physically, it looks like this. You have a red light source. This is a lot of red color. You have a lot of blue object, which looks a bit weird. You multiply these two things together, you get this. And somehow, our brain now needs to figure out the color of this guy. But you can't. You only have this information. So how can you figure out the color of this guy? Well, you know something about the light source. If you assume the light source is red, you can sort of divide this signal by red, and you get blue. But for the brain to solve this, it needs to know either about colors of objects or and about colors of light. So, when I ask you the color of this dress, your brain needs to make a lot of computations because there's not enough information in the picture. So typical material and dress colors, perhaps you would know something about. The daylight color, whether it's blue or yellow. The ambient light color, whether around the picture you have something. The color of the camera. All of these things the brain needs to take and to compute and to make a judgment from. Now often, as you will know, often in daily life, you have no problem to interpret colors. But in this case, it really, really doesn't work because I told you the photograph of the dress is very bad. It has been overexposed and a lot of these cues are ambiguous. So if you then assume that there is a cool light source, a blue light source, you will see white gold. And if you think the light around the dress is warm or more sort of yellowish, you will see a blue-black dress. So for those people who answered white gold, your brain has assumed this lighting situation. And for those of you who answered blue-black, the brain has assumed this light source distribution. Now, unfortunately, I explained to you why some of you may have a different interpretation, but why your brain is white gold and why my brain is blue black, I still have no idea. Why does my brain make this assumption and your brain makes a different assumption? So somehow, among all of us, our brains are all different, and this difference gives rise to those different dress interpretations. And this difference somehow needs to change what color we assume outside in the world. And now the scientist's job is not only to say, okay, where does the illusion come from? We know it now. It comes from assuming which color the light has, but explaining why my brain assumes this and your brain doesn't. So then scientists are, trying to do this. Now, if you go outside, which I encourage you to do, it's nice outside, you will see this light distribution, actually that's sunlight at noon. You actually see sunlight, surprisingly, has a lot of blue and green in it. It's actually very cool, like that's why the sky at noon is blue, right? Now, if you use these lights here, not these lights, you can actually, maybe you can see them perhaps, the lights, the stage lights, or the lights here in the back, they are warm, they look yellow reddish. Whereas actually the other lights here, the neon lights up there or the energy saving lamps, they look a lot more white blue, okay? Now historically we didn't have those white lamps. Most of the time old light bulbs, they give off this kind of light. So people who are indoors a lot, who used to be indoors a lot a couple decades ago, they all got this kind of light. So they assume warmer light sources. And people who go outside a lot, they have a lot more cold distribution. So this may explain it. Okay, then I have to explain who sits outside and who goes inside. But other things can happen too. So remember the eye, and at the back of the brain we have the retina, and it does color. So here those guys, there's a red guy, there's a green guy, there's a blue guy, and those give us color vision. So when light hits the eye, actually it needs to go first through the lens. And as you age, the lens changes, and people are born with different lenses, with different color properties. So that may be a reason. Or how these guys actually are sensitive. They're like a camera. Some people have a very good camera, some people don't have a good camera. And not only that, for each camera element, but also how many of these color guys you have is also different among all of you. So that may also explain some differences. And we also have a brain, right? So after here's the eye, here would be the eye, it gets routed to the back of the brain. Here's where visual processing happens in the brain. Again, don't ask me why, it's in the back. So the red area here, which is underneath the brain, again the eyes are here, let's go like this, the red area does some kind of color processing. So maybe some of your brains have something in here that's different from what I have in my brain. That could be the other reason. All of those reasons can explain those individual differences, why some of you are white gold and why some of you are blue black. So this is basically the summary of what science knows right now. Basically saying that a full understanding of the individual differences in how the dress is perceived will require data that relate on a person-by-person basis how you perceive the dress, white, gold, blue, black, with a full set of individual difference measurements of color vision. So I need to measure how many cones you have in your retina, what your brain does, how your lens is made, whether you go outside a lot, and everything, because basically, well, sorry to say this, science has no idea. Okay, we don't know yet. We can explain why you may have the illusion, why some people see this and some people see that, but I cannot predict who will see what. So, unfortunately, we have no idea. So, actually, one of the things that's fun, so beneath this, you can see other pictures of the dress. Now, this is the original picture. Now, if I do something to the colors of the picture, I can make it like this. Now, the colors of this dress, to me, look yellow. Actually, to most people, will look yellow. And the color of this dress is pink. Now, I didn't do anything to the picture except to change the colors a little bit. Now, for this picture, people get super divided. Some people say white, gold, some people see blue, black. But for this, or this, or this picture, people see a unique color. Pink, yellow, well, this is gray, right? So there's something special about these colors as well. And people are thinking right now how to solve this kind of stuff. So the brain has some very, very smart algorithms that help you to make sense of the world, because sometimes there is not enough information about the world that allows us to interpret this. Most of the time, these algorithms capture common sense, like cubes are more common, light comes from above, faces are convex, the world does not change much from one second to the next, and daylight has a certain color, for example. And all of these algorithms allow you, in normal life, to really go around and just have fun and don't get surprised by the world. The reason why there are surprises here, why I can show you this, is because the brain, like I said, is not a physics measurement device. So, for the final 10 minutes or so, I will overload your brain now. I will tell you a little bit about, actually, a bit of my research. And my research, like I said, is to try to understand how the brain goes into the world. And I'm interested in one of these things that has to do with that chair picture. We can actually recognize so many objects, people, faces, everything. You can recognize hundreds of thousands of faces, objects, and words. You have no problem usually. And I'm very interested in how this happens and how the brain can do this. So you can actually ask, I know each object here. So maybe in the brain, I have like a picture collection like this. Lots of different things. These are musical instruments, objects, whatever. Now, if I show you this, you say, well, that doesn't look very good, okay? This looks like a very messy thing, like some of the things that my graduate student's desk would look like this. But that it doesn't really make a good representation, right? It's just a bunch of pictures. We know each picture, but this has no structure. So how can we be a little bit better? Well, you know, we can talk about things. So how about words? So these are words, wall, chair, ceiling, window, buildings, and so on. And those words have different sizes. And the sizes are proportional to how often they occur around us. So window occurs a lot, whereas a coffee table itself is not so common. So this is okay. But again, window is next to car and next to sidewalk. That makes really no sense. So again, this representation has some structure, but it's also not good enough. So cue this guy here, Roger Shepherd. He's a very eminent cognitive psychologist. And a long time ago, he made a proposal. So let's say we know about animals. We have seen a horse and a cow. We know about vehicles. We have seen a car and a van and a truck. And now we get a picture, a new picture of a chair. And we don't know what it is. So we can say, okay, a chair has four legs. Could be a cow, could be a horse. But it really doesn't do anything much like a horse or a cow. Doesn't move around. So maybe it's not an animal. I can sit in a car, in a van, in a truck, and I can sit on a chair, but again, I cannot drive a chair. So again, that doesn't make much sense. So maybe I'm making a new category here, and I will at some point call this category furniture. So he said, because things in the world have meaning, function, and they look similar, it makes sense that the brain also represents things in that order. Because the outside world has meaning and structure, so should the world in the brain have meaning and structure. So, can we find those spaces in the brain? Right? We have structure in the world. Can we find these spaces in the brain? So let's put people in the scanner here. And let's show them pictures. This is Roger Shepherd, who is a good guy, and this is myself, who's not so eminent. And you just show these pictures to this person. You measure their brain activity when they look at Roger Shepherd, and you measure their brain activity when they look at myself. And then you compare those brain activities, okay? So we show lots of pictures. And this is a brain activity to Roger Shepherd, and this is a brain activity to me. And you ask, how similar are these brain activities? Now, with those, you show lots of pairs of pictures or lots of pictures to people, okay? Whatever, objects, faces, animals, what have you. For each picture, you measure brain activity, and you measure somehow how similar they are. And then you take a very fancy algorithm that converts those similarities to a map of all pictures. So here is that experiment, and you can see faces here, monkey faces here, animal faces here, animals, body parts, fruits, places, signs, tools. Now this is taken from your brain when you look at those pictures. So what happens here basically is you're looking at neural activities, you're looking at brain patterns. So actually, the brain pattern to Roger Shepherd's face and someone else's face is very similar. And these brain patterns, in turn, are similar to how monkey faces, because they're close by. Face brain patterns are very dissimilar from places, pictures of outdoor places. But those are all similar. And those guys here, fruit pictures, are similar. And tools get similar brain activities. In fact, if you look closely, these guys here, these guys, all of these guys are artificial objects. And all of these guys here are natural objects. And all of these guys are bodies. And all of these guys are faces. So in fact, our brain, the actual activity in the brain, my actual neurons firing, encodes structure and meaningful structure. And I didn't ask the person anything. I didn't get any reply from the person. The person just sat like lie in the scanner and looked at pictures. And from the brain activity, I can find this structure. So yeah, our brain knows about this. And we can even pull it out of the brain by showing things that are similar. So, final thing that I will show you. My interest is in this guy, because when you learn, you don't learn only by watching things. As you know, when you have a baby, they touch everything. They take in the mouth, they like slobber on it, whatever. So from day one, we actually perceive the world using all senses. I was talking just about the eyes, but we have lots of other senses, and they get into play from day one. So I'm very interested in this combination. So I'm interested, I can ask you what it feels like to touch this. You would say it's smooth and cool. And if you touch this, it's probably warm and a bit rough because it's wood. Now, this is a picture. If I ask you what it feels like, you need to take that picture and relate it to your touch experience, because you've touched porcelain before, you've touched wood before. Now this, it's a fun thing, it's a surrealist piece of art from 1930s. Actually, one of my favorite ones. This evokes a very strong sensation in your mouth, right? You can imagine really very quickly what it feels like to try to drink from this very weird cup of fur. So there's a connection between what you see and what you touch. And even if you take away this texture, if you ask about just shape, objects, they come in a million varieties. All of these things happen somehow, and we have no problem to interpret any of these guys here. So this is astounding to me. We have no problem to do this kind of thing, and I'm very interested how the brain does it. But I know that a lot of these things we experience not only by looking, but also by touching. We touch a lot of hands, we touch faces, we touch play toys, and so on and so forth. I'm interested in how vision, like seeing and touch, work together. And I will just show you one experiment of how this works, and then I will stop. So what I'm doing is I'm taking a 3D printer, okay? Perhaps you guys have heard of this. And I'm designing objects in the computer that are three-dimensional. I print them out in 3D, and they will look like these blobby shapes. So then, I am putting people, and they explore those objects. You can see here a person who does something like this. They're blindfolded, so they just touch the objects. And I do a very similar experiment to the brain. I let them touch objects, and then compare the objects, and then I ask them, how similar is this? And from this, I can reconstruct their perceptual space. I can reconstruct how similar people perceive these objects. And I will show you an example right now. So let's say we start with this object here, which is a weird geometric object, and then we put texture on it. We make it sort of corrugated. So that's one dimension. And then in the other dimension, I'm taking blur, I'm blurring the edges here. So this is a very edgy object, this is a very round and soft object. And I could do all combinations. So this here is a textured but blurred object. And I create this space and I can print them out. So these are pictures of these actual objects. So then if you touch this and then this, they feel very dissimilar. If you look at them, they also feel very dissimilar. So I'm exactly doing this. I'm showing you this guy and this guy, and you say it's very similar. I'm showing you this guy and this guy is very similar. I'm showing you this guy, and you're saying it's very dissimilar. So from this data, I can actually look into your brain and find out how you perceive this space. I just plot this space, but you know, in the brain, it may look very different. So this is the result. So the gray guys are the original objects, and the black guys are what you give me as a result when you look at some of these objects. And this is the same as if you touch the objects. So you need to imagine you're blindfolded like this, and you just touch some objects, and you say, oh, it's not so similar. And then you open your eyes, and you look at the same objects, and you also say, oh, it's not so similar. And in fact, your brain gives me the same idea, gives you the same idea whether you touch the objects or whether you look at the objects. So what does that mean? It means actually seeing and touch share parts of the brain. And this is fascinating because we are very visual people. But actually your hands are very, very powerful. When you touch something, the information you get is very good. And perhaps when you start out as a child, that's actually where the information comes from. So a child, a baby, their eyes are not so good yet, but they can touch very well. So their touch sense is very, very well developed. So maybe if we're talking about the world, if I touch these things for the first time here, actually that's how I get their shape information. That's what makes me so good at interpreting objects. It's not the fact that I see them, it's also the fact that I have touched many objects before. And that helps me to understand how things create in the world. Okay, I'll just move on quickly here before. So final thing. You can also do the same idea with faces, okay? So let's start out with this face. This is a Korean face here, you can see this. If I change something about the face, I can make this face look more Asian. Or I can make this face look more Caucasian. Or I can make this person more male. Or make his sister. And in each cases, the identity of these two guys look very similar, but their sex changed, right? This is a sex change operation. And with this kind of idea, this is another one of these spaces, right? This is another one of these where we represent faces by saying, okay, we have something like this here, and then we represent the changes in this. The structure of faces around us, we know they change with age, we know that this is age axis here, we know that they change with gender or sex, we know that they change with ethnicity. So maybe our brain has a very similar representation. And if I create faces like this, that's exactly what we do, we investigate in very great detail how we perceive faces, how we perceive age, how we perceive gender, how we perceive personality even, how we perceive facial expressions, how we perceive ethnicity here, whether you're a Western person or an Eastern person. And in all cases, what you find is actually that the brain has a very good idea about this. The brain knows the structure outside. It really knows that. And whatever you do, the brain can extract that structure and use it, and you will find the structure in the brain and in your behavior. So, as a summary, your brain uses lots of smart algorithms, actually a fair lot, many more than I had time to talk about. And it needs to use this to interpret the world, because the world sometimes does not give you enough information. And the brain represents objects in the world in terms of ordered and structured relationships. So when there's something outside in the world that has meaning and that has structure, this is actually how the brain represents it. There is no magic happening. The brain takes knowledge and represents it in that relationship that is important for you. And this relationship is, because objects are similar, even similar across senses. So whether you look at something or you touch something, as long as they talk about the same relationship, the brain has the same idea. And you can use this concept of this ordered space to investigate shape, faces, facial expressions, and so on, because it's such an underlying principle of how knowledge is structured in the brain. Knowledge mirrors the outside world structure. All right, with that, thank you very much for coming out on a Friday morning, and I'm very, very happy to take questions. And looking forward to coffee afterwards. Thank you very much. 예, 감사합니다.
교수님께 박수 부탁드리고요. 질문 있는 학생들 혹시 손 들어주시면 마이크 전해드리겠습니다.
May I have a question?
Yeah, sure.
What are the similar and different things between mind and brain activities?
Between mind and brain activities? Well, so, like I said, if things in the world are similar, if two faces are similar, even physically similar, and that is important for us to get it, our brain activity will also be similar. In fact, you can turn this on the head and say that whenever brain activity is similar, these objects, this whatever you investigate for us, will be similar, and we will behave similarly to them. So sometimes, in some of these illusions I showed, we can't tell the difference between two distinct objects, okay? And for example, or the other way around, let's say it here. So if you measure brain activity to this patch and to this patch now, the brain activity in the color areas will be different. and you will perceive them as different colors. But the brain activity to these patches will be the same. So I can find out what the brain thinks and what the brain is thinking about similarity and differences by looking at brain activity. So this is something similar to mind reading, except it's not quite so fancy. But as long as two stimuli are perceived similar and I can act similarly on them, my brain activity will be similar.
Thank you for your great talk, and I enjoyed it. I have a question that you can't recognize the rotation of hollow mask, and I think that if someone practice that the hollow mask is just a mask, and he assumed that there's a virtual axis, and so he practiced that hollow mask is rotation. So there is some possibility that someone can recognize that mask is just rotate. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, it's a very good question, and you're completely correct. And the reason why you're correct is when you train yourself, your reality, your concept of what the world offers changes, right? Because suddenly you're confronted with lots of data about an actual hollow face. And because you train yourself, it becomes important to your brain. And the brain is not stupid. It takes this into account, and it will change your knowledge. It will change its prior. You can also do experiments. I told you light comes from above. You can actually, if you let people go in an environment that light comes from below, they will switch in this interpretation. So the brain, you're not born with this. This is also important to know. For most of these things, you are not born with those, with this knowledge. You learn this knowledge. If you are in a different environment, your knowledge will change and reflect that environment. That's the important message. Yes, so if you train, you can change.
Thank you.
Hi, my question is regarding your own research. You mentioned the connection between touch and vision. And that brings me back to what I've learned a little bit about synesthesia.
Yes.
So to my understanding, synesthesia refers to connection of different senses, and it's mostly limited to certain people. So not everybody has synesthetic abilities.
Yes.
So, but in this sense, could we say that we're synesthetic to vision and touch because we are able to experience them at the same time, like make correlations?
Yes, in a certain way. So you collect information together. So this picture here, sorry, flipping again. There we go. This picture here. This is a synesthetic experience. You see something, but you may get a strong feeling of what it would be like to touch this. So this is something that you experience because of the statistics of your daily life, right? You experienced fur texture, and you experience this. But for synesthetes, what they experience is something that is outside of the natural correlations. So it's something, for example, the most common one is they would see letters or numbers in color. Now, normally in real life, neither letter nor numbers have colors. But this is the most common synesthesia. And this, people still have no idea where that comes from, because that correlation does not exist in the outside world. So this is something where the brain has connections, and they are very stable and meaningful. But where those connections come from, people are still talking about. And there are some very famous painters and artists and musicians who were synesthetes. And if you, I have a good friend who is a synesthete, and he associates space with number. So I ask him, where is 15? And he says, here. And I ask him, where is 105? And he says, down there. And he can point to numbers in space. And that's how he also does math. He just multiplies space around. It's very crazy. But for him, it's very stable. It's not a joke. You can fix and see really where his number space is. So there are some of these connections that the brain makes. And I presume that what happens is you take a space of things like letters, objects, or numbers, and you map them onto a perceptual space. Because letters, numbers, and objects have structure, and colors and space and these things that synesthetes and sounds that synesthetes experience, they also have a space. So you can map them together. And some of those mappings may be no more natural for the brain. But really why this happens and what things go together, people have no idea. So by far the most common is this, the color, seeing colors in letters.
Hello, my question is that we, as an Asian, we can easily distinguish the Chinese people and Japanese and Korean, but the Westerner cannot distinguish their, cannot find any difference about for their face.
Yes.
So do you think it's because of our different experience or because of the different brain system?
Well, both. It's because of experience. When I came here to Korea first, I saw, damn, everybody has black hair. And I'm like, Because when you see a person, most of the time you actually don't look at their face, you look at their like glasses, hairstyle, and so on. This is much more easy, and it's much more obvious, and you can recognize people from very far away by looking at their hairstyle. But like for in Europe, hair color is an awesome feature because people have different hair colors. In Korea, I have no idea. You know, everybody has black hair. So this doesn't work. But now I can recognize Koreans, it's completely fine because I have had lots of experience with Korean faces. And you can also explain this in this way. I have this picture here. So this is my face space. I know lots of people and I have an average face. Actually, this is an actual, this is the average Western face. And now here's a person I know. And what I can do is I can make a caricature of that person. Now this will exaggerate this person's feature, and by doing so, it will pull out this guy outside here. And you can see there are lots of faces here. So actually this person and this person I can confuse easily. But this person outside here is very lonely because there are very few faces like this. That's why caricaturing works. Now the trick is, if I see an Asian face, it will be here, up here. And actually, another Asian face will be here, and another Asian face will be here, another Asian face will be here. So it's very far away from everything, but all of these guys are close together, and I confuse all of them. So now when I get more experience, those guys here become pulled out, because suddenly my brain says, okay, hair color, I throw out. I need a different kind of thing, okay? So then my brain creates a new space like this for Asian faces, and then I can do this. In fact, you have the other way around. If you go to Europe, you confuse European people too sometimes because we all have long faces and long noses and stuff like this. So you have it the other way around too. But this is only experience.
예, 다시 한번 박수 부탁드립니다. 감사합니다. 이걸로 예, 강의 마치겠고요. 한 5분 있다가 예.